All right, guys, good morning. Let's get going on this chick in the background here and see how far we can get before I stop the recording. Got a good interview to put on today. I'm gonna start with the face.
Choose by color, taste, region, or price. Our product catalog features the premium red or white wines, champagne,
microns.
We also feature gift baskets, certificates, flowers, and wine accessories. Check out our wine club geared towards the true connoisseur. At Prime Wine, you can even select the best wine according to food choice. See the Whitley on Wine page at worldtalkradio.com.
So I think I'm just gonna do the small parts of the fingers with the micron, and then I'll switch over to the brush afterwards.
Okay, welcome back. You're listening to Comic Zone. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Eddie Keys in San Diego with World Talk Radio, and here's your host Vincent Cerzolo with Metropolis Collectibles. Vincent.
So how was your weekend? How would you do this weekend, Ed?
Oh, my goodness gracious. I did really well except for the final game of our championship weekend. Of course, I'm a football fan, and I was sorry that the Green Bay Packers didn't go through.
Really,
but
in my work
the
area,
most
there we go.
Exquisite weekend out here on the West Coast. Don't know what it was like in Manhattan.
It was freezing cold. It was absolutely bitter. I can't even explain how cold it was walking to the train station on Saturday. My wife and I decided to go over to Chinatown in Manhattan, and my face froze, literally.
Boy, I remember that.
Yeah, I definitely envy you living out in San Diego. It's so much nicer.
There's room for you out here, Vincent.
Yeah, I know. I watched the football games also, and I have a friendly wager going with a fellow comic book dealer in the New England area who's obviously a Patriots fan, and I went 1-4 this weekend. I didn't do very well, so I'm hoping to make it up next weekend, but every game was absolutely spectacular. I just was blown away by the level of competition. It's truly a great weekend for sports. But let's talk comic books.
Yes.
So we have Neil Adams joining us on the radio in a moment. I'm sure most of the people who are listening right now all know who Neil Adams is. I'll just give you a brief background. Neil Adams, when he came into the comic book world, wasn't immediately accepted, and actually took him a little bit of time to really get his get some good work on some recognizable superhero titles. But he did some great work on a Ben Casey comic strip for Archie Comics, and also for Archie Comics before moving over to DC. His work is considered groundbreaking. He brought a certain sense of a dramatic sense of photorealism onto the comic page that hadn't been seen before. Whereas I could contrast it slightly to Jack Kirby's, while not trying to take away from Kirby's style, which is spectacular. Whereas Kirby's style is somewhat over the top and truly otherworldly. Neil Adams' style.
Oh, that's the problem. I changed the aspect ratio. That's right. I was trying to record. Fix this real quick. Bear with me.
Two-dimensional superheroes. Once again, not trying to say that Kirby's artwork made them feel like they were two-dimensional superheroes, but his work on Dead Man, the Green Lantern, Green Arrow series, and of course Batman are regarded by many collectors as the best work ever done on those characters. Not only was Neil a revolutionary artist, he also championed the rights of fellow artists. He helped to improve artists' pay, benefits, royalty payments on when artists' artwork was reprinted.
All right, bear with for a second, guys. I gotta.
Right around the time that the first Superman movie with Christopher Reeves was coming out, Neil, along with Jerry Robinson, championed the plight of Joe Shuster and Jerry Siegel, the creators of Superman, to try to get them some type of recognition and payment from DC Comics, since they basically had created the cornerstone of everything that is comic books.
See if that does any better.
And they were successful in
on the fly making fixes. And I'm probably not going to remember to edit that out. So I've been using these lately. They're a lot cheaper. It's a point liner. Works pretty good.
Sounds like Superman.
Knows and everything. In a certain sense, I think many of us regard you in that regard, in that way. Neil,
troublemaker. I said
troublemaker.
All the way.
Neil, it's great to have you here. I don't know. I doubt you recall meeting me. I was my first person-to-person meeting with you was at a big Apple comic convention about 7 months ago, and it was towards the end of the day, and you hadn't been very busy the entire day, and you were kind enough to do a very quick sketch after you, I think, received the permission from one of your family members who wanted to make sure it was okay to do a sketch for a collector. You did a quick sketch of Batman for me, which is in my portfolio of convention sketches, which I greatly appreciate, and it was very kind of you to take the time out to do something like that.
If they don't appreciate the fans, I just don't think they're regular folks. I try not to draw sketches for everybody because it would just take up all the time and energy that I possibly have. And, you know, some folks come by to talk. But, you know, it's kind of nice to do a sketch for folks here and there. And I really try to be nice to everybody who comes by.
Yeah, I think that's definitely something I've heard whenever people tell me that they've met you at shows, whereas I've heard... I won't mention names, but I've heard a lot of bad things about certain creators, artists, writers who can be somewhat pompous or arrogant. And I think maintaining a certain level of humility and being a humble person.
Well, I wouldn't say I'm a humble person. I just think if people are paying you money to draw pictures and tell stories,
right,
then you're pretty lucky. And I don't see any reason why anybody should take that upon themselves as being anything special. It's a very fortunate position to be in. People actually give me money to draw pictures. And I tell people, you know, that in a given situation I hate to admit this to you, but I do it for free.
Wow. That says a lot. That really does.
Artists are pretty lucky folks, you know. We don't have to go out and dig ditches and drive buses like other folks. We're awfully lucky, and, you know, we appreciate everybody else's hard work, and we bless the fates that allowed us to be able to do this.
Great. And I don't think of myself so much as an artist, because, you know, when you draw every day, you know, you kind of
true at any time and for any medium.
That's true.
But what is so wonderful is that you get these incredible stars of, in terms of artists and writers that rise to the top. Neil Gaiman, the fellow that's doing the Superman Smallville show, is writing with Jim Lee to do a Batman series. You just get wonderful things that are happening. I mean, Alex Ross, I mean, you know, the names just tumbled out of your mouth. The Kubert boys, I mean, one Kubert who continues to draw comic books has also added two new Kuberts to the business. Wow. And they're doing great comic books. I mean, we just have a wonderful business to be in. It's too bad that there aren't more stores that sell the comic books. And the business does seem to have that kind of brown edge to it where, you know, golly, it's kind of going back to a mom-and-pop store, only it's called a comic book store. It's not a candy store anymore. And multi-million-dollar entertainment companies are buying these properties that are just holding on by their fingernails and making motion pictures and TV shows.
Right.
It's a really incredible time.
You mentioned Norman Rockwell. I would imagine he was somewhat of an influence on your artistic style.
Only that he was great. I mean, he was, I would have to say, and I would argue with almost anybody about this, the preeminent artist and illustrator of the early part of the 20th century, though. Nearly the whole of the 20th century in America. There's nobody whose artwork represents what America was about more than Norman Rockwell.
How do you feel about Maxfield Parrish?
Well, I think Maxfield Parrish is fine if you like women in gossamer clothes sitting by pillars and having the sun rising behind the trees behind them.
There's something to be said about that.
It's very decorative. I think it's terrific. I laud all these people, but, you know, Norman Rockwell was the storyteller of illustration. And I think that we have him to look to as an example of what we should aspire to and, you know, what we should, the kind of life and the kind of creative life that we should try to achieve. It's being an artist and being a creator is not just being talented, putting stuff on paper. It has to do with how you live your life. It has to do with how you control your life and your family and how you deal with other people and what kind of a person you are and how that's then reflected in the artwork that you do. And then, is the artwork worthy of what you do? And then, is it possible for you to aspire to something a little bit higher than just the regular run-of-the-mill stuff?
We're speaking, no problem. I'm sorry, Neil. We're speaking with Neil Adams. We're just going to take a quick break. I hope you can stay with us as we get through to the next segment. Neil? Okay.
Neil, you'll be with us in the next segment. Just hang tight. We'll be right back. Thanks so much.
Okay, you're listening to Comic Zone on World Talk Radio. Eddie Keys here with host Vincent Cerzola from Metropolis Collectibles. We're speaking to Neil Adams. More coming up straight ahead.
Site and
processing, membership management, and search engine optimization, to name a few.
Take advantage of the full power of the internet using Avalar technology at www.avalar.com.
Great.
That's AVALAR.com.
Trying to get me struck. Jeez.
Collectibles fits in.
That we have this, you have this, this wonderful job that you do for free. And I've often had the same type of thing. I'm not sure if you know much about what we do, Metropolis Collectibles. We are probably the largest dealer of vintage comics in the country, if not the world. We have over 100,000 vintage comic books in stock. And
you probably have two of mine.
Absolutely. If you're ever interested in coming down to our gallery, you have an open invitation. We have we're on Broadway between 18th and 19th. We have original art hanging on the walls. Along with that, you seem to be a monster fan. We have the rarest movie poster in the world, a six-sheet Frankenstein. We have a six-sheet King Kong, one-sheet Dracula, both styles, three-sheet The Day the Earth Stood Still. Just to name a few of them. And I think you'd really enjoy
all press of that.
Excuse me?
You sell prints of them?
No, these are just part of our
gallery. You get to look at them, but you get to buy them?
You get to just look at them, and if you're really good, I'll let you touch them. And we, along with that, we have the covers of House of Secrets 92, Detective 28 and 30, Superman 16 hanging on the wall. So it's really a beautiful gallery, almost like a museum. And, of course, if you're ever in the area, you're more than welcome to come down and take a ride. It's the same type of thing for me. A lot of people will say, wow, you know, you get to deal with comic books all day, and it is fun, but there is a business side of it, and that's the side of it that I don't like so much. I enjoy buying and selling, but it's just great to just be able to sit down and read a great bunch of comic books. And some of the comic books that I remember of yours, I mean, of course, there's the Batman work you did, the Green Lantern, Green Arrow books,
which they seem to be reprinting time after time.
Yes, and they're great stories. It's fantastic to look at the artwork and read the stories. But some of the artwork that really some of your comics that I first got exposed to, believe it or not, as a comic book dealer, I started buying all these collections. I started when I was about 16, 17 years old. I'm 32 now. And I started buying these collections. And whenever I buy a huge collection, sometimes I buy a store out, and I get these full runs of stories. And I'd go through the boxes, and I'd pull out whatever I'd like to read. And on a rainy day or weekend, I'd sit down and I'd read a run. There's nothing like reading Conan 1 through 100 in one clip. It's the best way to read that type of story. But some of the stories that I read by you are comic books like Armor, Silver Streak, Megalith, Toy Boy, Crazy Man, I think it was one, Valeria, She-Bat. And I'm just wondering, I mean, these were, in my mind, the art was great, the stories were fun and exciting, the characters were really, really a thrill to see what was going on next. Are there any plans to get into those again or to bring them back?
Well, the problem, of course, is that the comic book business is a very tough business to be in, and almost everybody who's in it is backed by somebody with a lot of money. I don't want to say that DC Comics is a losing proposition, but you have to know that DC Comics really wouldn't be there if it wasn't for all the licensing for all their characters.
Absolutely.
You also know, for example, that Marvel went into debt and went into bankruptcy to the tune of $400 million or more. Nobody seems to quite know the number. And now that movies are being made and licensing is being done and there are sterner hands at the helm, well, they're doing fine. I don't know if they're making money in the comic book stores, but
right.
they, as a business, they're doing well. What I decided to publish was almost by accident because a publisher that I was working with went bankrupt, owing me a lot of money. So I decided to take the work I had done with him and to publish it myself. And then we went on and we thought, well, maybe we'll become a publisher. And things got sort of hairy. And then there was this big rise, volcanic-like rise, when Image started.
Right.
And we were able to make a chunk of money for a period of time, but then the bottom fell out. Everybody was printing a million copies. being an artist, I have to be a businessman. I have to say, okay, we're pulling the plug on this one. Step back.
What about going down different avenues for these characters, like animation?
Well, we are, in fact, but we're doing it a little bit more slowly, a little bit more carefully. I mean, we have a book out called Monsters,
right?
Which is one of the projects that I had started then, but now we've done it with computer coloring, and I've added all kinds of work that I've done for film companies on the Dracula movie, Childhood's End, a Stuart Gordon film, a bunch of stuff in the back with the graphic novel, with all this music, computer coloring.
You know, I was
go ahead.
I'm sorry. You want to finish?
Anyways, it's like ours kind of stepping back and going, okay, here's one of our projects here, guys. You know, and then we can try another, be a little bit more careful about it and conscientious about it, because first of all, people sort of expect quite a bit of quality from me, and you know, when you rush stuff, you know, it's like 1 in 10 gets to be good. We don't really like to do that. We like each one to be good.
I want to be careful. I was fortunate to look over at your website, neiladams.com, over the weekend, and I was reading up.
That did everybody. Go to neiladams.com, take a look.
You like how I put that in there, huh?
Well, hey, my son designed that website, and he's maintained that website. It really is a fun website.
Yeah, it's great. It's great. When I went over there, I was looking, reading about monsters, and from what I gathered, you basically wanted to take what Universal did with the monster movies and bring it to some type of final climax where you had all of the main monsters, Frankenstein, Dracula, and the Wolfman, duking it out in a comic book. Now, were you inspired by any chance by, you know, there were films that touched upon this House of Frankenstein, House of Dracula, and of course, you know, everybody's favorite, Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein.
You know that, you know, when I do Superman, I do Superman, right? I do Batman, I do Batman. I don't try to change it. I try to make it the same. And I remember seeing these Frankenstein movies and Dracula movies and werewolf movies, and I thought, and in those days, I thought, gee, you know, what's happening is that everybody's taking them and corrupting them and messing them up and turning them into something else. And then, of course, they have to modernize them. And the best attempt to do these movies over again was the Hammer films. You know, they did a pretty good job, but they were very different, you know. And there was this attempt, but, you know, it's something about the gypsy camps and the castles and the lovely young ladies with the fair skin and all of this melodrama, I felt, you know, had never been put together finally in one project where you have all three, Dracula, Frankenstein, and the werewolf, and maybe even Vlad as Dracula, real original Vlad.
Right.
And maybe modernize them, but not modernize the project. In other words, don't, you know, keep it in Romania, you know, keep the gypsies and all the rest of it, and try to, you know, bring back that flavor that was so originally wonderful. And so I did it as a graphic novel. I brought all three of the characters together and came up with a real reason for them to be together, which was necessary for the story, and did this thing that is essentially act of love, you know, for those monsters. They don't look like exactly like the old Universal monsters. There's, you know, they look different, and of course,
more modernized, I'd say.
And I would say if they had made those movies today, same movies, they would sort of look like what I've done.
And you're going to be doing a signing at Forbidden Planet, which is a great comic shop here in Manhattan.
They were nice enough to ask me to come down. I think that's real nice.
Wednesday, January 28th. I'll just look down for a second. They're located, if anybody wants to go and meet Neil in person, 840 Broadway, the corner of 13th Street on Broadway, Forbidden Planet, one of the premier comic shops in Manhattan. And Neil's going to be there January 28th. So Wednesday at 6 p.m.
Right.
So that should be a really exciting night for you.
Well,
to meet up with some of the fans and to basically...
I'm sure everybody's having a good time.
Yeah. So let's move a little bit over to this new project you're working on, which you said it was... You have a couple of working titles right now.
I have one working title. I have one working title. It's called A Conversation Between Two Guys in a Bar, or A New Model of the Universe. My suspicion is that the title will end up being "or."
So,
because you got to keep it short, you know, and that's way too long.
Yeah, this is something, though, from what I understand, you've been working on this for 35 years, and it's not...
No,
it's
I
not
didn't actually...
Hero. he's not a superhero comic book fan, so don't.
Well, I'll tell you something. I warn people about this project, and I tell people, look, you know, it's boring. I don't want you to really read it. Just kind of know that it's there because, you know, it's about science, and you don't want to get too close to science because that's like real life. I know everybody thinks that I should be drawing Batman, but
maybe not about Batman explaining the new model of the universe.
Yeah. And punching guys while he does it.
There you go, exactly. It has to be a villain, right?
Right. Exactly. Well, it's a little hard to convince people, but, you know, people do sort of have faith in me that I'm not going to let them down. And my feeling about it is that, you know, there are some stories out there that aren't exactly the same kind of stories that you know you get in an adventure bag, but they are fantastic stories. And the idea is if it's a fantastic story and it's such a fantastic story, why not tell it in a comic book? Why not tell it in a graphic novel? And this one has a videotape. This will, of course, is going to be a DVD. That's 2 hours long, that shows and explains it just like you were watching, well, the Discovery Channel, you know, how we do that at night when everything else is no good on television. We go, oh, let's see what's on the Discovery Channel.
Right.
They've landed on Mars, and they're looking for water. They got this little robot out there digging for water. I don't think he's going to find any.
Right, right.
Anyway, this project, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, this book seems to, you're trying to answer some questions about how the Earth formed, how did dinosaurs become extinct? Was there a Big Bang? Was there
actually? I'll tell you what I'm trying to do. You know, when you were in school, remember you were in school and the teacher said things like, well, you know, light is a particle on a wave, and you kind of sat there and you went, sure, really? And I had a particle on a wave, and you'd kind of raise your hand, you go, how can it be a particle on a wave?
Right.
I'm going to be both. And they said, well, because Einstein says that he came up with this theory after you had a bunch of other theories, and he says it sometimes has the aspect of a particle, sometimes the aspect of a wave. And you go, it doesn't make any sense, teacher. And the teacher would say, well, it may not make sense, but it's going to be on the test on Friday. And if you don't know it, you got trouble. And, I, as a kid, I always loved science, but I always hated that kind of aspect of where, you know, they jammed it down your throat and you kind of went, we happen to know that Tyrannosaurus Rex existed on all seven continents. All seven continents. Cool, you mean on Antarctica too? Yes. According to this theory, Antarctica was once subtropical, and we can dig in Antarctica and find dinosaur bones, and we can find the bones of a duck-billed platypus. What do you think about that? And so we all go, wow, that's really cool. And so they say, well, this is the theory now. What we say is, because this is true, all these things are true, all the continents were all together on one big giant island on one side of the earth. And I step back, and that's a supercontinent. And I step back, and I'm an artist, right? And I can see three dimensionally pretty good. And I'm looking at this planet that they're saying existed, and it's a planet, and it's got one big giant island on one side of the earth. That has levels coming out of the sea, like mountains and all kinds of stuff. And the rest of the earth is a giant ocean, two-thirds of it to three-quarters of it, 4 miles deep. And I'm looking at it, and I'm thinking, guys, I'm not talking to anybody because I'm, like, dwelling in my head. Gosh, how could this have gotten this way? I mean, it's one thing to say that the continent is cool. That's already, in my mind, I'm visualizing these Warner Brothers ants, picking up the picnic basket, and the little guy with the trumpet going, marching across the bottom of the ocean. But those continents are kind of plugged into the bottom of the ocean. They're not, like, floating in the water. How do they do that? There must be some process that allows that to happen. So they had not a lot of answers in those days, but they simply know it happened.
Neil, can you hold that thought? Because we'd like to continue with this. And this is really important stuff, actually, from what I'm hearing. And we want to get the full scoop on it. But do you mind if we take a quick break and hold you over?
Okay.
All right. Vincent?
Be right back, folks.
Stay with us. You're listening to Vincent Cerzolo in Keys on Comic Zone with special guest Neil Adams. Plenty more ahead.
Alright, we went 37 minutes. I got a lot of erasing to do, and then I'll start messing with the background stuff on the next video. Thanks for hanging out with me, guys. I will see you on the next one. Where's my mouse, though? Here we go. Alright.